Hey guys, welcome back to another Unfiltered Gamer Kickstarter board game review. Today's game up on the tabletop, Extraordinary Adventures Pirates! It's by Forbidden Games by Glenn Drover, and it is for 2 to 5 players. In the game Extraordinary Adventures Pirates, you're going to be sailing the high seas with this race-style deck builder. This game is similar to games like Clank, and also to a game like the Pirate's Flag, and where you're going to be trying to build your deck to best move your ships, or utilize those cards for their abilities, to gain cards from ports and to gain cards from merchants, in which you'll be able to utilize these things to gain victory, treasure tiles, as well as trying to win in a race. There's a lot going on in this little game, but the idea is, of course, building your deck and making your ship get to the very end of the last port. There's 3 different roads to victory, and with more players comes more interesting strategical choices and ways you can manipulate the cards. And of course, when you go first to second, third, and fourth, you're going to be getting different bonuses as well. The game is pretty simple. It's going to involve getting you 10 cards, and there's different types of cards that you're going to be starting with. And whoever is the race finisher is going to end the game. You're going to tie the points up, and whoever has the most is the winner. Anyway, let me go ahead and show you all the contents of the game, Extraordinary Adventures Pirates, and we will then talk about it. So here we have the game Extraordinary Adventures Pirates and everything included. So let's go ahead and talk about everything included, and then I will show you how to set up the game. So the first thing is you're going to notice a bunch of cubes. You're going to get cubes from all the different colors here. They're going to be brown, yellow, blue, and green, and red. We're using black cubes instead of brown because that's what we have. You'll also be getting these boat meeples that are going to be used for each player. And of course, you're going to be getting a deck of 10 cards for each player. You got the blue, purple, green, red, black, and yellow. It says 5 players, but there's 6 total player colors here, so there might be an extra player. I'm not too sure. You're also going to be getting a deck here, which is going to be your merchant deck, I believe, or your it's one of your decks here, which you're going to be able to use when you go to these. Oh, but it's a port deck. When you use these port cards, you can gain them by going to these locations here. And you also have these merchant decks here, which you'll gain from going to these locations here. They have cards that are going to span from 2 to 3 points, which I'll explain in a little bit. You're also going to be getting these treasure cards here, treasure tiles, in which you're going to gain victory points as you collect them. You're going to be gaining these from going to different ports and utilizing your cargo to pick them up, which is important because it's part of the game and how you get victory points. You're also going to notice that over here is a full board of the game, which tells you in a 2, 3, 4, and a 5-player game how many victory points you'll get for being in first, second, third, and fourth, depending on the number of players, based on these 3 tracks here. You've got black, red, and blue, and they all symbolize going to the same location here, which is going to be Trinidad, but you're going to start in St. Augustine, you're going to start over here in Havana, and of course, Granada, there you go. And so you'll be sailing. Now I put all the ships here, here, and here. There are the 3 tracks, the 3 starting points, this is the ending point, and as you can see, you're going to be going across here. Each of these different little merchant vessels here are going to have a little red dot next to them, or dots, and you're going to randomly draw the dots from this bag here, which are going to be cubes, and put them down in all these locations. Some of them will have 1, others can be up to 4. It just really depends, and they're all going to be based on the different areas in which you're going to be going across the board. Make sure that you have 3 boats, 1 on each of these sections, and 1 additional boat is going to be in front of you. That's going to symbolize your player token here. You're going to put them all into a bag and then draw one. That will determine your first player. And then take one of these decks, depending on your boats, and that is going to be the first 10 cards you'll be using in the game. Make sure you then deal out 3 from this deck here and place it face up, and then shuffle the merchant deck and go ahead and set it aside. You'll be utilizing these later. And of course, you're going to draw the number of players times 3 plus 1 for these treasure tiles here. And you're also going to be taking an additional number equal to the number of players after these run out, provided that they do before somebody finishes the game. This is the setup for the game, as you can see, and everything included. Let's go ahead and talk about how to take a turn. So Extraordinary Adventures Pirates is fairly simple. You're going to be getting a deck of 10 cards, and everybody's going to get the same deck of 10 cards. And there's 3 different types in the deck. You're going to get a Sailing Master's Mate, which has an ability written on it, as well as a number. All of the cards are going to have a number, but some of them that are special will have abilities. This one specifically says that you can discard a card from your hand out of play, and if you do that, you can't use the number. Well, the numbers are for moving the ships around the board, and you're trying to use your ships to get across 2 ports and merchant vessels, as well as one of the ships is going to also finish the game by getting to that last spot on Trinidad. The other cards you're going to get are the Able-Bodied Sea Seaman, which are going to give you 2 points, and then the Lubbers, which will give you one. And they're basically the simple weak cards that you're going to get in most deck builders. You're going to shuffle your deck up, and then you're going to draw five, and so will everybody else. And on your turn, which is very simple, it's going to be based on the starting player, you're going to simply play three cards from your hand. Now remember, if you're going first, you get to play first, which is your benefit. If you're going second, you're going to take a random cube from the bag, that's the leftover cubes. If you're going third, you get to choose to pick from the remaining cubes that were not drawn. And then if you're going fourth, you will take a random card from the merchant deck, and if you're going fifth, you could choose one of the three. So there's benefits to going last, of course. Now, when you are playing your three cards, you can choose to either utilize the number, which will move your ship, or you can choose to use the action, which is going to do a specific thing. Some of them will give benefits to different routes, and others are going to do certain things like move your opponent's ships or move your own ships, providing benefits and all that good stuff. Once you've played three, you'll be moving your ship based on the number or using your abilities, and then you're going to draw back up to five cards. And whenever you run out of cards from your deck, you're going to shuffle and then draw the remaining card. So it's going to function like any normal deck builder does. Whenever you land on a merchant, you're going to be taking any of the cubes that are on the merchant, and you're going to be drawing a merchant card from the merchant deck. And whenever you land on a port, you're going to be able to draw a card from the port deck, or you can pick any of the face up of the three port cards that are available to you. You can also spend cubes to buy these specific treasures, which are going to give you victory points at the end of the game. If you ever run out of treasure cards, you're going to add equal number of treasure cards to the number of players one time before the game ends. It may happen, and it may not. And then you're going to pass turn. On your opponent's turn, they will do the same thing, moving their ships and whatnot. And what's interesting is, once the game ends, players are going to score based on the number of players, first, second, third, and fourth place, gaining victory points along each of the different tracks. You'll also score based on these victory point tracks. And from the merchant deck, port deck, you can also score from treasure cards, which are laid about, strewn about here randomly. This one here is a one victory point treasure card. Whoever has the most treasure at the end of the game is the winner. Let's go ahead and show you a little bit of a walkthrough as to how a turn or two is played, and then I will tell you what I think about the game, Extraordinary Adventures Pirates! So here we are back to Extraordinary Adventures Pirates, and it's set up for three players. So I went ahead and removed all the rest of the player ships and the rest of the player decks. The other player decks I went ahead and put here, and put them in first, second, and third place. Basically, second place got to draw a cube from the bag at random, which was a yellow one. And then this player here chose the red one specifically, because there was a good amount of red tokens here, and there was the least amount of red in the bag. So probably a harder resource to gather, I suppose. As you can see, the merchant deck is going to be right here. It's going to consist of twos and threes for the most part, and over here is twos and threes for this port deck here, which is very useful. If it was a four in a five player game, the fourth player would get to select a card at random from the top of this deck here. If it was a five player game, the fifth player would get to select any card they want or simply draw. Anyway, so let's go ahead and get to it. I went ahead and put these treasures out as well for three players, which is 3 times 3 plus 1, which would be going to be 10. And if these get run out, there will be three more. Okay, so everybody is here at the start. There's three areas here, three different tracks, and they're all trying to get to Trinidad. As soon as one boat hits Trinidad, that's going to end the game, and players are going to tally up the points either from their treasures from their port deck or their treasures from here, which are going to be based on the cubes that you utilize and spend here or any of these locations, as well as first, second, third, and even fourth place in a fifth player game, but depending on the number of players. In a three player game, it's going to be a first and a second place for each of these tracks. So if the game ended something like this on that track, that is going to be first, second, and third place. So just to give you an idea of how each of the tracks work individually. Okay, so to start off a game, everybody has their 10 cards. They went ahead and shuffled. They may or may not have additional treasure or loot. And then they're going to simply draw 5 cards, and they're going to go ahead and play. This one here has a 3 ones, a 3, and a 2. You can either choose to play these cards for their special ability or choose to play them for their number. So if I wanted to, I could simply play these 3 cards for their number, which is going to give me 6. The rest of the cards would stay in my hand, and then these would go into my discard pile, which I then can move my ships 6 spaces. These, I am blue, so I can go ahead and move them 1, 2, 3. Maybe I want to move this one 2. Maybe I want to move this one 1. And that's how a turn works. After that, you're going to simply draw up to your from your deck up to 5 cards into your hand once again. and I'll leave your discard there. If your discard, if your decks are ever runs out to your discard, you're going to shuffle your discard and make a new deck, and then you will continue to play just like that. Play would pass to the next player, and they would move their ships. So I'm going to go ahead and move these boats across the board a little bit, just to give you an idea of how the game is going to function at a later date, basically making it a little more interesting, I suppose, as well as explaining some of this stuff better, because the first couple turns are pretty simple. Okay, so now let's say it's yellow player's turn. They're going to go ahead and draw their five cards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then they're going to play, and they've got three twos. They'll play three twos, which is going to give them six, and then they'll keep the ones in their hand, and then they're going to go ahead and move. So 1, 2, 3, perhaps, and 4, 5, and 6. So if they did that, they're going to score on each of the ports. They have their individual boats, which will give them their treasure, which is pretty sweet. And also you're going to get a card from the merchant deck for each boat that lands on these spaces. They're going to be either twos or threes, so you can get these guys, which will go into the discard pile. Another thing that could happen is if you land on these ports here. These ports are going to let you draw a card from the port deck, which is either going to be one of these three face-up cards, or simply drawing a card from the top of this deck. If you pick one of these cards here, a new one is going to come and replace that card, making it so that it's always going to be an interesting pool to choose from. Now, they all have abilities on these ones here, whereas the ones in your hand may not, and in this deck here, they do not as well. So, or for the most part, they do not, I think. Anyway, so that's the basic idea, right? Moving around, whenever you land on these spaces and there are no treasure, you're not going to be able to draw from the merchant deck, and whenever you land on the port, you'll also be able to do something pretty interesting. So, for instance, if yellow actually had their character lay on one of these ports here, they could spend these if they're able to and get one of these cards here. So for instance, they could spend a green and a red, and then they can go ahead and pick this up and put this into their tableau, which will give them three victory points at the end of the game. And that's how it works. So it goes around in turn order, in clockwise order fashion, until somebody reaches the end here. Once that happens, you're going to tally the points first, second, third, fourth for each of these areas here in victory points. You're going to tally up all of the points that you've gathered from collecting these resources and then turning them in at ports to get these treasures here, which give you different points, anywhere from like 7 points to 3, as well as, of course, any treasure cards in this deck here. There are certain cards in here that are going to give you treasure that are going to give you 2 or 1 victory points, so it's another way to get some bonus points. And that's the basic idea of the game. Extraordinary Adventures Pirates, trying to get across as much as you can. Sometimes you don't need to get first place in order for you to win, you just need to have the most points at the end of the game. Okay, so let's come up and talk about it. Okay, so now before we get into the game and what I think about it, let's talk a little bit about caveats. The first thing is 10-card deck, draw 5, play 3, choose the actions or choose the number, move your ships to the amount of numbers that you've chosen, and if you land on a port, you're going to draw a port card and you're going to take the cubes. You're going to take a port card, and you can potentially also use your cubes to buy treasure, or if you land on a merchant area, you're going to take the cubes, and then you're going to be able to draw a merchant card, which are the basic ones here. And then after that, you're going to end your turn. Whoever gets to the end is going to end the game, and the people who get first, second, and third in each of the rows will gain victory points. Whoever has the most points at the end of the game via all the different ways you can gain points is the winner. Let's talk about some of these port cards. For instance, Storms. You can pick this one up at a port. It's going to give you a 4 on it, which will let you move your ship's 4 spaces. But if you spend it, you can move the lead ship on one track back 10 spaces. Very good, but it gets rid of the card for good. There's a Cook here. Place 2 cubes from the bag at 1 empty merchant ship location. That'll also get rid of this card, and it's a 2, which is not so bad. Sailor from Santa Domingo, which is you can move 4 on the red track or 2 on any other space. Sailor Maker, 2 plus 2 on any track where you begin your turn in last place, so it can be 3 or 5. That's really cool. Sailor from St. Kitts, plus 4 on a red track, and a Smuggler, minus 1 cube per treasure. This card is actually placed in front of you until you use it on a treasure, then you're going to be able to make your treasure collecting easier to do. These are the different treasures they gain from anywhere from like there's 3, here's a 5, here's a 6, and it's just going to be based on the amount of treasure that you're going to need in order to score them. And of course you can only get them from the ports and if you have the correct cubes and or resources in order to pick them up. If the deck runs out, no problem, right? That's how you play the game. So What does it remind me of? Well, the first thing it reminds me of is Clank. That's the first thing I think of when I played this game. But it also reminded me of a game called The Pirate's Flag. Well, The Pirate's Flag is about drawing cards and playing cards and moving the spaces that you of the cards you've played, including rolling a die. In this game, it throws in a deck builder as opposed to rolling die and playing cards, in which it makes it less take that and more strategical as to how you want to build your deck, which of the different ships you want to move, and how you want to go about getting first, second, third place, as well as collecting the treasures and the treasure cards. Which there are a few in here as well. This game, if I were to rank Clank on a scale of complexity, it would probably be at like a 7. This one here is probably about a 5. And of course, you can make it more complex. The more you play the game, the better you get at it. And then the Pirate's Flag is probably like a 3, maybe a 4. It's very simple, but it's a mix between those two games in which you're trying to outrun and outmaneuver your opponents, as well as you're trying to build the deck, your deck as best as you possibly can by removing the bad cards, adding in good ones, and trying to mess your opponents over with the decks that you have available to you. Now, this game is really, really fun. I really enjoy the aspect of being able to customize my deck as well as throwing in a race. I do like Clank, specifically. It's a really fun little game. It has one small flaw in it, and this one here is going to have something in which I think is going to fix it with more players. Two players, you kind of forget about one of the tracks most likely because you can't win on all of them. So it actually becomes one player's guaranteed one track, one player's guaranteed another, and then there is one final track, which is kind of the real race and where that's headed. And it works. There's no problem with that. But it does mean that when you play with more players in this game, it's going to be a lot more fun. It becomes a lot more competitive as well, because on a two-player game, only first is all that matters. You get 7 points for first and nothing for anything else. So with three players, four players being even more fun, and even five, it adds to the complexity, but it also adds to the time of the game. A two-player game is rather quick and pretty simple. You draw cards, you play cards, you're done. And then you may get some cubes or some other cards. It's very, very simple as to how it's played out, but how you build your deck and where you want to maneuver your ships around is going to be based on which cards you choose in the port deck, and there are quite a few different cards you can choose from. The artwork is rather nice. I enjoy the look of the game. Like I said, it also reminds me of that Pirate's Flag style art with a little less kiddiness to it and a little bit, but still like a cartoon animation, but it feels a little more like a animated Pirates of the Caribbean kind of feel to it. I don't know. It works. I really like the artwork for this game specifically. And I definitely recommend playing with at least three players in this game. I wouldn't play it a two-player game again. I enjoyed it way more at the higher player count, but it does play at two players. It just plays differently in terms of you're mainly focusing on one specific aspect of the game, whereas the craziness is more of the appeal for me. If you're a Clank fan, this one might appeal to you as well. If you want to add a racing variant and want a more simplistic game for maybe your younger kids, as well as the fact that it can get a little more complex as well if you so choose to make it like that, but it's a nice stepping stone into those more complex deck builders. Overall, it's a fun game and I enjoy it. I like the artwork. I think all the different meeples are nice, the little ships are nice, adding in the extra tracks. What I would also like to see with this game is I want to see more different spaces on the different tracks to do different things, maybe add something interesting, like for instance, Clank has different spaces that will give you certain things. I'd like to see even more with this game. But the simplicity is also a nice aspect, like I said, for younger players. And it does feel like it would function more as a kid's, more on the kids' level, but adding in those extra spots might be more interesting for us older players. And anyway, up to you guys. If you enjoy games like Clank, you're going to probably enjoy this one. If you played the Pirate's Flag or know anything about that game, you'll probably enjoy this as well. And if you're not a big fan of deck builders, if you don't like, if you're looking for more of a two-player game, it's probably not your thing. And if you don't have, I think four players is a solid aspect of this game is really where you want four or five players. And it has a little bit of competition, but it's not a huge amount of take that. So overall, up to you. Personally, right on the level with me, a decent game, something you should definitely check out. If you're interested, look in the description below. It's currently on Kickstarter. Extraordinary Adventures, Pirates. I wonder if they're going to have more different ones. Extraordinary Adventures, Murlocs. Alright guys, thanks for watching another Unfiltered Gamer Kickstarter board game review. If you like this video, go and check the rest of our videos here on YouTube. Like, subscribe, and comment. And all this help, we do greatly appreciate it, as well as taking a look at Extraordinary Adventures, Pirates, as well as Ninjas. Ninjas could be a cool one next. As well as taking a look at our website, unfilteredgamer.com, to the blog posts, giveaways, Kickstarter lists, and more. We're going to be giving away the game Dogs. We're already giving away two right now. There's a bunch of cool stuff on the site, as well as artist pages if you're interested in an artist. All right. Also, check out everythingboardgames.com and the Giveaway Geek. It's been a while since I've done this one, apparently. And that's it. That's all I got for you. I gotta say something else. Look forward to sailing the high seas with you next time.